Right, this is the appointed time. We have a quorum. Welcome to the meeting of the Bills Committee on Construction Industry Security of Payment Bill. This is the second meeting we're having this morning. Following the first meeting, we will continue to examine the bill. And at the end of the first meeting, we stop at clause 58, subclause 2. I will invite Mr. Tang to continue. Yes, we stop at C2, and perhaps I should finish D first about exercising the right to delay work as mentioned before the intended starting date. If the admitted amount is not paid in full, then this is one of the conditions under which the right can be exercised. As for the notice of intention, it must be in writing. It is served under this ordinance, and it should indicate the claiming party's intention to delay carrying out the construction work under the contract, subclause 4, unless the claiming party specifies the intended starting date in a notice of the intention. The date after 5 working days after the date on which the notice is served is taken to be the intended starting date. Now, I'd like to point out that we will be reviewing the drafting of this provision, because here it says the date after 5 working days after the date on which the notice of intention is served is taken to be the intended starting date. What we mean to say is that after serving this notice on a Monday, the intended starting date will be the Saturday subsequent to Monday. But the way this is drafted will give a misconception that there is another day following that before the intended starting date begins. So we will review that. Subclause 5, a claiming party exercising the right under subsection 1, and then A, is not to be regarded as in breach of the construction contract, and the claiming party is not liable for any loss or damage suffered by the paying party as a result of delay in carrying out the works. The claiming party is entitled to a reasonable extension of time to complete the contract. The claiming party is entitled to recover from the paying party any loss and expenses that have reasonably been incurred as a result of the delay. The claiming party must also resume the carrying out of the work within 5 working days after receiving the payment in full. So that's basically about clause 58. Mr. Chan Siu-ho, Deputy Chair. Thank you, Chair. 3 questions. I thank the PS for explaining this bit about the date after 5 working days after the date on which the notice is served, and that they will be improving the drafting of this subclause to address possible misunderstanding. Now, I'd like to turn to subclause 5E. Does it mean 23.5E, as mentioned in D, is entitled to recover from the paying party any loss and expenses that have been reasonably incurred? Does it refer to the one in clause 23.5, additional payment? Another point I'd like to make is that according to the industry, when discussing the bill, they are very enthusiastic about the bill's passage so as to address the current issues of cash flow issues. However, there is a misunderstanding from the industry that they have the right to suspend or delay works. So in the event of non-payment, the subcontractor can suspend works without incurring any liability. I'd like the administration to confirm that regarding the right of a claiming party to delay work is very narrow in scope. In other words, only when the claiming party fails to receive the amount from the paying party, which the paying party has already undertaken to do so, then the claiming party can invoke this section to exercise its right to delay work. However, the prevailing situation in my sector is that very often the paying party would either refuse to respond to the claiming party's request for payment or disagrees with the amount to be paid. So it's a rather common scene, and this scene will not be addressed by Clause 58. So what happens if the paying party refuses to pay up or refuses to pay the amount in full? The adjudication proceedings will then be initiated. And only by invoking the proceedings will we see another scenario that is described in Clause 58. So I want to address this misconception that it's not the case that the claiming party can just suspend or delay works anytime they like. I'd like the PS to explain that.
Right, for Clause 58, there are conditions in the sense that the paying party would have to send a payment response, and if there is no response, is it the case that that would be it? Permanent Secretary. Like Member said, Clause 58 deals with the scenario in which the paying party has promised to pay but ended up not paying. So the claiming party can then exercise the right to delay work or supply. We will talk about Clause 59 later, where there is no response or there is no payment after response. The claimant would first have to make a dispute, or the paying party should make a dispute. And after a determination is reached, the paying party does not pay. And that would be what happens in Clause 59. Now, for Clause 58.5d, is it possible to tie in with Clause 23, the provisions in relation to additional payment? Well, it depends on whether there are contractual terms dealing with such scenario. If there is, then one can make use of Clause 23. If not, they would still have a power for the claiming party to make claims, asking the paying party to pay them for any of their losses or expenses. All right, any follow-up questions? Any other questions from members? If not, please proceed, Mr. Tang. Thank you. As said earlier, Clause 58 is very similar to Clause 59. Clause 59 deals with the scenario in which the paying party does not pay the amount determined in the determination. Then the claimant would have the right to delay work or supply. The wordings are similar to that of those of Clause 58. I'll repeat them here if you won't mind. So Clause 1, if all the conditions set out in subsection 2 are satisfied, a claimant may delay carrying out the construction work or supplying the related goods and services. But the conditions in Clause 2 are a bit different. So in Clause 2, the conditions are A, the respondent has failed to pay to the claimant the adjudicated amount in full by the payment deadline of the adjudicated amount. B, that after the payment deadline of the adjudicated amount and at least 5 working days before the intended starting date, which I mentioned earlier what it is. The claimant, 1, has served on the respondent a notice of intention that meets the requirements set out in subsection 3, and 2, has notified the owner of the claimant's intention to delay carrying out the construction work or supplying the related goods and services, and C, that the adjudicated amount is not paid in full before the intended starting date. After these conditions are met, the claimant would have the right to delay work or supply. Subclause 3, a notice of intention must be in writing, state that it is served under this ordinance, and indicate the claimant's intention to delay carrying out the construction work or supplying the related goods and services under the construction contract. Subclause 4, unless the claimant specifies the intended starting date in a notice of intention for the purposes of subsection 2, the date after 5 working days after date on which the notice of intention is served on the respondent is taken to be the intended starting date. As we said for clause 58, the date after is a bit confusing, so we may amend this. Subclause 5, it sets out in several scenarios, a claimant may exercise the right under subsection 1 and will not be regarded as in breach of the construction contract, which is exactly as stated in A. B is not liable for any loss or damage suffered by the respondent or by any person claiming through the respondent as a result of delaying the carrying out of the construction work or supply of the related goods and services. C is entitled to a reasonable extension of time to complete the contract. D is entitled to recover from the respondent any losses and expenses that have reasonably been incurred as a result of delaying the carrying out of the work or the supply of the related goods and services. And E must resume the carrying out of the construction work or the supply of the related goods and services within 5 working days after the date on which the claimant receives the adjudicated amount in full. That's it for me, Chair. Alright, if we read clauses 58 and 59 together, if the claimant makes a claim, the paying party undertakes to make a payment but end up not paying, the claimant may delay work or supply. Or when the claiming party makes a claim and the paying party does not give a payment response at all, then they would have to first go into adjudication, and it is only after determination is reached that the claiming party would have a right to delay work or supply. I think after the deliberations of Bills Committee, this much is clear, and the legislative intent as well. It's not the case that without payment one can delay work or supply right away. There are conditions involved. All right? Members, any questions? Mr. Lewis Loan. Thank you, Chair. For the Bills Committee, we are now at this point of the scrutiny of the bill. We need to give a pat on our shoulders, really. For the construction industry security of payment, the views of the industry are that they would support the bill, but there are many details to be fleshed out. That's why it took so long for us to get here. I would like to thank the administration for taking into consideration the feedback of the industry, so that there are 2 separate clauses in relation to the claiming party's right to delay or work or supply. But let me say this, Chair, for the construction industry. It is often the case that in construction sites, there would be workers saying, with banners saying that they have worked, but they have not received any pay. So with workers being paid, this is only normal. Their rights are protected by the employment ordinance. I want to ask, so for this bill, It does not replace the functions of the employment ordinance in the sense that it would still be the case that workers' rights are protected under the employment ordinance. So after workers have worked, they should be paid, right? Their employers, if they do not pay the workers should fight for their rights. They shouldn't be thinking that with this bill, they will no longer be protected, right? Because security of payment is not for wages of workers. Their wages have always been protected by the employment ordinance. I think the Labor and Welfare Bureau should advertise this so that workers will exercise their rights immediately instead of waiting for months and then they will be on camera having a banner with them saying that they have not been paid. All right, Permanent Secretary, I agree with what Mr. Louis Leung said. Workers being paid is a responsibility of employers, and indeed, this right is protected by the employment ordinance. This bill deals with the arrangements between contractual parties. It does not deal with employer-employee relations. But with that said, this would still help the construction industry in the sense that because there will no longer be a delay in payment, the subcontractors can pay their workers in time. We want to have a more healthy construction industry so that companies would have enough money to pay their workers. So this will help indirectly. And when we were communicating with the different trade associations, they think it would help in this regard. Well, Chair, let me say this. I agree with what the administration said, but I think we need to remind workers that they should exercise their right as soon as possible instead of waiting for months for that. The Development Bureau and the Labor Department will definitely try to enhance publicity to remind workers of that. Thank you, Mr. Dennis Leung. I think what Mr. Louis Leung said was quite right. This bill is about disputes arising between contractual parties and the resolution of such. If a subcontractor does not have the money to pay workers, that is a different thing, and that right should be protected under the employment ordinance. But let me say this, it is often the case that the subcontractor does not get the money and they would have the workers holding banners before cameras saying that they have not been paid, in the and pressuring the main contractors to pay the wages on the subcontractor's behalf first. So before a determination is made, we may have a scenario in which the claiming party would exploit the workers. They would ask the workers to hold banners before they would pay workers, or making it a condition for them to pay the workers. Or they would say that during adjudication or in the stage where the claimant is delaying work or supply, they will say that they are not going to pay the workers. Will there be criminal liability on the part of the claimant? I think we should make clear this because we need to let workers know about this, and they should be protected in such scenario. Thank you, Permanent Secretary. The bill, as I said earlier, is relevant to disputes between contractual parties. As for in the scenario in which the claiming party, without having a determination, exercises the right to delay work or supply, let me say this, the bill does not give them the right to do that. They will not be protected under Clause 5 of the bill. Or 58 or 59 of the bill. For the contractual issues between contracting parties, that would be a different issue. But if workers speak to the media asking for wages to be paid, I can't really comment on this now because it really depends on the circumstances, how they're doing this. Is it peaceful or is it something else? Has social disorder been disrupted? There are many different factors at play. Thank you. Well, I think it is as Mr. Dennis Leung said, the issuance of wages is protected under the employment ordinance, so we should not really link that with this bill. But I think, as another member said, we should communicate with workers more so that workers won't be used in the disputes between the subcontractor, well, the claiming parties and the paying parties. Okay, so we have completed this scrutiny of Clause 59. We will now go into Part 5, Miscellaneous Matters. Mr. Tang, please. Thank you. We are now on Part 5, Miscellaneous Matters, Clause 60, Interpretation of Part 5. There's a definition for function. It includes a power and a duty. Clause 61. Functions of Secretary. Secretary is defined in Clause 2 to be Secretary for Development. Subclause 1, for the purposes of this ordinance, the functions of a secretary are A, to oversee the performance of the functions of a nominating body, B, to establish and keep a register of nominating bodies, and C, to perform any other functions that are conferred or imposed on the secretary under this ordinance. Subclause 2. Without limiting subsection 1, the Secretary may A. determine an application for registration or renewal of registration as a nominating body, B. suspend or cancel the registration of a nominating body, C. regulate the fees of a nominating body or adjudicator, D. give to a nominating body any direction that the Secretary considers appropriate in relation to any function of the body set out in Section 63, and 63 relates to the functions of nominating bodies. E. Inquire or investigate into a complaint or information against a nominating body, and F. require a nominating body to provide any document or information in relation to any function of the body set out in Section 63. Subclause 3. The Secretary may, in writing, delegate to a public officer any of the Secretary's functions under this ordinance. Subclause 4. However, the power to delegate conferred by subsection 3 may not be delegated. I want to talk about 62.1d as well. During the previous Bills Committee discussions, some members have expressed concern in the sense that with the directions of the secretary, whether it would reflect what is said in clause 63 for the functions of nominating bodies, especially with the promulgation of education rules, codes of practice, guidelines, etc., whether the secretary's directions can be consistent for the nominating body's reference. We are consulting legal advice. We may make appropriate amendments. We will consider including for the secretary for the three types of documents I mentioned, setting out the functions. Thank you.
Munger, Lam.
Questions, Mr. Andrew Lam. Thank you, Chairman. Mr. Tang already answered half of my question with his introduction. I'd like to follow up on one point. With the code of practice, the guidelines, I assume in the implementation of the bill, there are bound to be different situations that require reviews or amendments. In this regard, do you have any plans to conduct reviews from time to time? P.S. Thank you, Chairman. In Clause 61, Subclause 2D, we'd like to tell members the main contents of the document. The purpose is to let the ANB know the secretary does have some requirements. After the bill takes effect, the task force will continue to collect views from the industry. Parties to the adjudications will also express their views. We'll collect their views and see if there is any need to amend the contents. Then the ANB will consider whether they will make amendments accordingly. The timetable for carrying out reviews is not set in stone. It all depends on whether the ANB thinks there is a need to do so. Any more questions? Mr. Dennis Lam. Thank you, Chairman. In Clause 61, it sets out the Secretary will establish and keep a register of nominating bodies. The bill does not provide for any requirement for the ANB to establish or keep a register. I mean, there is no register of adjudicators. Will there be such a provision? Under section, Clause 61, B mainly focuses on ANB's register. When it comes to the register of adjudicators in subclause A of Clause 63, there is a provision providing for a list of adjudicators, and we'll come to that later on. Mr. Tang, please continue. Thank you, Chairman. Let's move on to Clause 62, Right of Appeal Against Decisions of the Secretary. Clause 62 mainly provides that one can appeal to the Administrative Appeals Board a decision to suspend the registration of the body corporate as a nominating body. An appeal does not suspend the decision unless the Secretary decides otherwise. I have already covered the contents of 62.1a.b.c. As I mentioned, unless the Secretary decides otherwise, an appeal does not suspend the decision, and this is the content of Clause 62. Let's move on to the next one. Clause 63 is about the functions of nominating body. It provides A, to establish and maintain its panel of individuals for the nomination and appointment of adjudicators. As the PS mentioned, a list of adjudicators has to be kept. B, to nominate and appoint an individual to be an adjudicator in a course of adjudication. C, to receive and refer adjudication notices to adjudicators. D, to regulate the conduct of adjudication proceedings, including the making of adjudication rules and practice notes of the body for matters in relation to adjudication. E, to make and administer a code of conduct for adjudicators. F, to establish and publish schedules of fees and expenses for services provided under this ordinance by the body. G, to provide training for individuals who are on its panel on adjudicators. H, to provide the secretary with documents or information required by the secretary. And I, to perform any other functions that are 1, conferred or imposed on the nominating body under this ordinance, or 2, directed by the secretary for the purposes of this ordinance. These are the contents of Clause 63. Any member has questions? Mr. Dennis Leung. Thank you, Chairman. As I was asking, there will be a list of adjudicators. How can claimants or members of the public access this list of adjudicators? In Clause 61, there will be a register. How can members of the public apply to view the list or the register? P.S. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Dennis Leung. 2 questions. Let me first talk about the list of adjudicators. We require that the ANB keep this register, but there is no requirement as to the disclosure of the register. So how do we gauge whether an adjudicator is a suitable one? We are conducting a procedure in the adjudication rules. When an ANB receives the case, the ANB will look for suitable adjudicators. Not only 1, but 2 to 3 at least. Information about the adjudicators will be given to both parties. Then they will have to see whether there is any interest, which, if any, has to be declared. Then both parties can express their views on the shortlisted adjudicators. That is, their preference, their views, which will then be considered by the ANB. So both parties have opportunities to see which adjudicators are on the list or have been shortlisted. In Clause 61, it also mentions a register of nominating bodies. It doesn't provide for any disclosure of the relevant register. We'll consider if it should be made a requirement. Any question? Yes. The ANB is set down rules of adjudication. I believe there won't just be 1 ANB, there will be more than 1 ANB. So does each ANB have their own adjudication rules? Are there any standards to adopt? Or is there any consistency? Both parties will have to refer to the adjudication rules. So are there any channels for both parties to view the adjudication rules more easily so that they can select adjudicators? Thank you, Chairman. Under 61D, Clause 61-2D, the Secretary may give to a nominating body any direction that the Secretary considers appropriate in relation to any function of the body set out in Section 63. For code of practice, guidelines, and so on, the administration has already prepared such documents, which will then be given to the ANB for their compliance. They will have to refer to the contents of the documents. Internally, there are procedures by which the contents will be slightly amended, or there may be more contents to be added. The entire documents will have to be given to the Secretary if they are to his or her satisfaction. Then he or she will consider whether renewal of the registration is allowed. Thank you, Chairman. Any more question? No, Mr. Tang, please continue. Thank you, Chairman. Let's move on to Clause 64. Nominating body may charge certain fees. Clause 64 provides a nominating body may charge a party to adjudication proceedings a fee for any service provided by the body in connection with the proceedings, including fees in relation to the adjudication. A nominating body may charge an individual a fee for including the individual in a panel on in the panel of adjudicators of the body, and B, charge an individual who is included in the panel of adjudicators of the body a training fee. Clause 65, immunity from civil liabilities. 65, brackets 1 and 2. Adjudicator or nominating body, brackets 2, secretary or public officer, and 3, subsection 2 does not affect any liability of the government for the act of omission of the secretary or the public officer. Clause 66, adjudicators not compellable witnesses. Clause 66 provides adjudicators cannot be compelled to serve as a witness in any civil proceedings in relation to construction industry security of payment disputes, including A, any civil proceedings in connection with the payment dispute, or B, an arbitration in connection with the payment dispute, or C, any other dispute resolution proceedings in connection with the payment dispute. Moving on to Clause 67 and Clause 68, there are about requirements in relation to the service of documents. Clause 67, service of adjudication documents. It applies to documents in relation to adjudication. A document that is authorized or required to be served under Part 3 other than an adjudication notice or written notice under Section 27, Brackets 3B or Brackets 4B must be served A, in a way specified by the nominating body concerned, or B, if no way is so specified, in a way specified by the adjudicator. These are the contents of Clause 67. Mr. Gary Zhang. Well, I have no question. I pressed a button by mistake. Sorry. Well, Mr. Tang, please continue. I was on Clause 67, brackets 2. An adjudication notice that is authorized or required to be served on a nominating body or selected body under Section 25, brackets 3A or brackets B, 5, 6, or 7 must be served on a body in a way specified by the body. No question, Mr. Tang, please continue. Clause 68, service of documents on parties. This section applies to the following sections, including A, that is authorized or required to be served under Part 2, Section 27, Brackets 3B or Brackets 4B, or Part 4. the documents I mentioned are covered under Section 68. The document may be served by a party to a construction contract on either on another party to the contract in a way agreed between the parties. This is Clause 68, brackets 2. Going on to section bracket 3, if no way is so agreed, the document may be served by a serving party on a receiving party, A, by leaving it at or sending it by registered post to the last known residence or place of business of the receiving party. That is subclause 3A. In subclause 3B, without affecting paragraph A, if the receiving party is an individual, by delivering it to the receiving party by hand. 2. If there is a record of receipt of fax transmission by the receiving party, by sending it by fax transmission to the last known fax number of the receiving party. Or 3. If there is a record of receipt of electronic mail transmission by the receiving party, by sending it by email transmission to the last known electronic mail address of the receiving party. Subsection 4. Subsection 5 applies if a document is served under subsection 2, but there is no agreement between the parties on how to determine the date of service of the document. Or B, a document is served under subsection 3. In subsection 5, the document is taken in the absence of evidence to the contrary to have been served on the receiving party, A, if it is left at the receiving party's last known residence or place of business on the date on which it is so left, and B, if it is sent by registered post on the day after the date on which it is so sent, C, if it is delivered by hand on the date on which it is so delivered, or D, if it is sent by fax transmission or email transmission on the date on which it is so transmitted. These are the contents of Clause 68. It's about the service of documents. Mr. Dennis Leung. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to follow up on Clause 68, brackets 1A. There are three choices under brackets 1A. 1, part 2, 2, section 27, brackets 3B or brackets 4B, or 3, part 4. Well, after A1 is the word or missing. In 3B, likewise, if the receiving party is an individual, by delivering it to the receiving party by hand, is it better to add the word or after these texts? Is it necessary to make an amendment here? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Dennis Leung. Yes, indeed. We meant A or B or C. That's about the drafting of the text. I'll give the floor to Mr. Zhang. Thank you. Based on our drafting rules, for more than one paragraph or 2 to 3 paragraphs, we put the word and or at last. That is for remaining characters 1, 2, 3. We can see the word or after brackets B2. But we can see the word or under brackets 4A. That's a different case. Well, my main point is the word or is not necessary in the part quoted by member. In clause 68, bracket 3, if there are two paragraphs or three paragraphs, then the logical link is shown at the second left paragraph. Yes, and that is a conventional practice. Thank you.
Thank you.
If there are no other questions, Mr. Tang, please continue. Clause 69, secretary may amend schedules. The secretary may, by notice published in the Gazette, amend schedules 1, 2, 3, or 4. No questions? Please continue. Part 6, related amendment. Related amendments in Part 6, that's Clause 70, Administrative Appeals Board Ordinance amended. The Administrative Appeals Board Ordinance CAP 442 can be found in paper number CB(1832/2024)02. It sets out the how the schedule is to be amended. Under the ordinance, we are going to add Section 80, Construction Industry Security of Payment Ordinance, and then bracket blank of 2024, a decision of the Secretary for Development, and then to refuse to register a body corporate as nominating body under Section 61(2)(a), to refuse to renew the registration of the body corporate, to suspend the registration of a body corporate under Section 61(2)(b), or to cancel the registration of a body corporate under Section 61(2)(b). So these are decisions covered by the amended Administrative Appeals Board Ordinance, such that the board will be empowered to deal with these matters. No questions? Right, we can then move on to the schedule. In our previous discussion, we also discussed the amendments to the schedule. Mr. Tang, I don't think you need to read out the schedules clause by clause. Just very briefly go through the headings and see if there are further questions from members. Schedule 1. In relation to the definition of residential unit in Section 2.1, and these are the three definitions. I think we covered that in our previous discussion, so go on. Schedule 2, a list of specified structures covering 15 types of specified structures, buildings, or facilities. Yes, I remember we covered that as well. Any questions? No? Mr. Andrew Lam. Point of clarification. In relation to... Right, please speak into the mic. A point of further clarification, because in relation to natural conservation, landscape, parks, etc. I don't think these are clearly set out here. Permanent Secretary. Thank you, Mr. Lam. I remember we went through this point and we clarified that this will be included in the list of specified structures. No, I think I need to make it very clear, because in some instances there may not be a structure. So I just want clarification from you. It's called specified structures because it's not confined to literally structures. It's just a term used here. Mr. Benson, look. Thank you, Chair. A point of clarification, please. Point 2 under Schedule 1, a student hostel. That's the expression used here. Well, I think that according to the prevailing government policies, we do have quite a lot of student hostels. We have student hostels or dormitories in universities. We also have youth hostels. And then we also have hotels being converted into youth hostels according to the Hotels and Accommodation Ordinance. Can you explain what this term student hostel means? P.S. I think refers to the meaning or the use of the premises, and that is its use as a student hostel. I will give the floor to the DOJ to tell you more about different scenarios and whether it covers the examples you've given, such as a hotel conversion. According to the Policy Bureau's direction, we've drawn up this schedule. There is not a clear definition in the laws of Hong Kong regarding a student hostel. So we take the general meaning and consider its meaning according to the actual circumstances. For example, tenants of the premises, who are the occupiers? For example, if the occupiers are students, then it's one consideration of this premises being a student hostel. Another consideration is, for example, is not a tenant, is not somebody with vested interest or privy to any tenancy agreement. This student may just be an occupier staying in the premises. And for the party providing accommodation, we consider the capacity of this provider, whether it constitutes a student hostel. So we consider a basket of factors in determining whether the premises could be regarded as a student hostel. Schedule 3. Bodies specified for definition of specified entity in Section 4, Subsection 3. There are altogether 28 specified entities or bodies. Now, at a previous meeting, there was a question on whether a telecommunications company should be included in this list as well. And we are discussing with the relevant government department and the telecommunications service providers. There will be a further discussion by the task force, and we may be moving an amendment to the schedule. Well, there is a big difference among different telecom operators. You may have in mind a major player, but there may be individual operators which also regard themselves as telecom operators. So we'll hear further from you about possible amendment. Schedule 4. Contract value of public contracts or main private contracts for purposes of Section 7.1A2 or 8.1A2. So it sets out where the line is to be drawn, and according to the two subclauses here, in relation to public contract, main private contract for the carrying out of construction work or the supply of related goods and services, it sets out the threshold of value to be adopted. Right, we went through that before. Next, Mr. Tang. Explanatory memorandum. So I think basically we have covered all the clauses. Anything else from members? Any further questions? If not, then I thank members for their hard work, and we've completed the clause by clause scrutiny of the bill. Right, legal advisor, any questions on the point of drafting and the English rendition? Right, no inconsistency has been identified between the Chinese and English renditions. We've made a lot of efforts, and I appreciate the hard work of members for putting some very specific questions to the administration, and likewise the administration already responded to members' concerns and agreed to move amendments. At the close of today's meeting, the Secretariat will issue a notice to ask members whether amendments will be proposed for consideration by the Bills Committee. I believe our comments have been incorporated by the administration in their proposed amendments. So far, I haven't heard from any member of this Bills Committee in relation to amendments to be moved in the members' capacity. So there won't be any amendments to be moved by the Bills Committee, right? Let's confirm that. We've completed the class-by-class scrutiny, but our work isn't over. The administration in the course already proposed certain committee stage amendments. So we should go through the draft of the CSAs at the next meeting, which is scheduled for the 8th of November 2024 from 9 a.m. to 12. It's a three-hour meeting. I believe there should be sufficient time for us to go through the CSAs. Once again, I thank members and the administration for your hard work. That concludes today's meeting. Anything else to say, Permanent Secretary? Anything you'd like to add? Once again, I thank Chairman and members for your invaluable input in the course of scrutinizing this bill. While we understand the practical concerns raised by members, so in light of that, we'll go back and review the entire bill, and we will be proposing some amendments, as Chairman mentioned. In relation to the Gazetted arrangements, we will fully communicate with the industry before taking it forward. Finally, I'd like to thank the deputations and members of the public for giving us their views. I believe the administration has collected some specific views at the public hearing. I just remember that there was unanimous support from deputations at the public hearing. So I look forward to passage of the bill to promote healthy development of the industry. That concludes today's meeting. Thank you.